Hello.
Oh, hi. It's Dylan. What a surprise.
Hey, you're that guy.
Hi, Ben.
How are you? Hi, Enforcer.
Can we come in?
Yeah, welcome.
Rad. Do you practice your favourite rock moves in your bathroom here?
Yeah, sometimes, like, put on a guitar and jump around, do a bit of...
In front of the mirror?
Yeah, I don't have a mirror in that room.
Oh. Have you got some more something to show us, perhaps?
Not really, but I do practice a lot of skanking in my room.
Really? Do you skank?
Yeah.
Really?
All the time.
What do you think the most important part of the skank is?
You just get the swing right.
The swing?
You gotta get it all happening.
Do you reckon it's in the actual movement or the end position? Because I reckon it's the end position. It's like the pose that
you end
up in. It
depends when you stop. Like, I don't think it really matters until the actual last...
part of the beat.
Yeah, till the last thing, that's it.
Then that's it. It's where you stop and hold it, isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah, but the flow's still gotta be right. Can you show me, just quickly, do you want some scary music?
Yeah. You
can I play this guitar? Okay.
I can't do it with these numbers very well, I don't know. Something like that, you know. Just the usual stuff, that's good. That was more kind of hillbilly.
I like the swing, I see what you mean. What kind of music are you influenced by when you were growing up and, oh, what's that? Are you ready?
Yeah, I was prepared. This is Harvest by Neil Young, which is my mum's seed, Jane Matum, before she was married and became John's.
Now she's JJ.
Yeah. This is Sabbath Bloody Sabbath, which is my favourite Black Sabbath album ever. It's an original vinyl copy, which cracks a lot. But
very nice. Favourite like song it. On there?
Favourite song on there is Killing Yourself to Live, which is the first song. Side 2. Very good. Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young. I think this is my dad's. He's a big fan of old Neil. Yep, whatever. Haven't listened to it.
What do you mean? Isn't it an influence?
Yeah, big influence. Yeah. This is a Deep Purple album, which is a little bit rare, I think. Who do we think we are?
Are you faking your history here?
No.
You're choosing the hippest albums. Where's all those Bryan Adams albums and Daniel Amam you had here a minute ago? That's what we need.
The Best of ABBA is also a big influence because of their
hair.
Haunting melodies.
And coconut hair.
No, this isn't... I don't consider Deep Purple cool. They're actually quite a... I just like them. They're quite hated by the punk community.
Right.
Because they're very, 70s wank rock, but I like them. They're good. And this is Rare. Jimi Hendrix and...
Lonnie Youngblood?
Yeah, that guy.
Together?
Together.
So two great
saxophone
experiences.
Saxophone and guitar and they just rock it on and...
What's that like? Have you heard that?
Yeah, this is good. This is my mum's. She's
awesome.
A
is it bluesy?
Yeah, it's bluesy. It's good. You'll probably like it. I won't show you, but...
That's why Daniel sounds like he does. But off the Freak Show album, here is Silverchair Now with Cemetery Live.
Special scene.
Silverchair in the new wave of Australian music are probably at the almost the, they're at the commercial pinnacle on one hand. I mean, they sell an incredible amount of records both here and around the world. And they also represent, you know, a lot of the traditions of Australian music in that, you know, very loud, raucous rock and roll.
They go off, they always have. They're a really strong live band, and I think it just took a while for the Newcastle people to realise what a good band they were.
Definitely on the road, it's trying to have as much fun as possible. It's often hard when you're travelling on a bus.
Let's do a survey of how many pissed off drivers there are on the highway. Come on.
Just those moments when everything sort of builds to a crescendo, when Ben just loses control, when Chris is sort of half drawn over his bass, when Daniel's screaming, just those moments when the emotions all add up and it just all wells over.
They still are one of the most talented bands I've ever seen. They write great songs. They can play live. I mean, I would have seen got 100 shows, and I still never get bored of seeing them live. For some reason, they all decided that Susan's hotel room was the place everyone was just going to land up.
How you doing, Dylan?
I'm doing splendidly well. I guess a lot of the main rock musicians in the world would choose to have their dream car eventually in their career. Is this your dream car?
This is my dream car.
And you've got it at the start of your career?
At the start.
Well, let's have a look under the bonnet.
The donk. All right, the donk.
So shiny. How did you first get into the band?
It happened one day when Ben and Daniel were just mucking around, and a guy said, why don't you just get a bass player? And I'd lived in the same street as Ben since we were about two. And he just said, well, why don't you play bass? He had a bass there, like, bought it off him for, like, $100. And we just went on from there.
How do you guys write?
How does it happen?
Yes.
Well, Daniel probably generally just comes in and says, oh, have a listen to this, guys. And we're basically in a practice. We practice and practice it at your door practice. And just, I don't know, if anyone's got any changes, I think, just word it across. And if we try and if it sucks, well, we don't do it. We just stick to the ridgy ditch.
What about the live thing? Is that big for you?
The live thing's the rock. That's the thing.
Is that the thing?
Yeah. Getting up there in front of some people and then enjoy your music and rock out.
Yeah, what's the best bit about it?
I don't know, just seeing people having a good time down there, hurting each other.
Yeah, when you see it working from what you're doing and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, fully.
Yeah! Well, bro, I can't understand why you'd want to stay here.
Neither can I.
You've been the person who's been singled out as the baddest in the band. How do you respond to being the bad boy of the band?
Oh, you know, I've got to uphold my image.
Mm.
You know. My name's Ben Gillies. I'm 5 foot something. I weigh 67 kilos.
And he enjoys water sports.
I enjoy water sports. I enjoy fishing. I enjoy playing my drum kit at home. I enjoy hanging out with my friends and just basically partying on, man.
Yeah.
Being the bad boy of the band, you've got a little bit of a headbutt routine down there with the kick drum. That's nice and slick. Does it always work?
Yeah, I use every single time that I've done it. Like, I usually like put a little cut.
That's cheating.
And then yeah, but you know you can't ram your head through a kick drum skin. It's impossible. So yeah, I used to put a little cut and then just headbutt it and it'd go straight through it.
And you go through.
But like, yeah, there was one instance where like, there was only one time where there wasn't a slip and it was on national television.
No. Was that the Arias?
Yeah.
That was awesome.
That was not good.
Yeah, it looks sick.
I like saw stars, like I hit it and like I went all hazy.
Why does the mayor like you so much?
The mayor?
Yeah.
I didn't know the mayor likes us.
He loves you.
I didn't know.
Check this.
They got a fairly radical message, sort of music I don't really appreciate, but they're well appreciated by the young people and they've inspired the young people of this city.
Don't tell us a little bit about your songwriting and rehearsing process. Where do you do that?
It's usually when we write songs, usually me and Daniel come up with like a riff or something.
Yeah, yeah.
And just go into practice and then we'll like jam on it for a while and just, you know, do whatever.
So do you remember when the song Abuse Me was created?
Yes, I do. One day Daniel came into band practice. Yeah, and then he said, oh yeah, I got this song, and then he showed it to us, and then he showed Chris the bass part, and I just kind of started playing along, and that was it.
That sounds like an explanation for any song being written. What about recording this bit of film clip for it?
Oh yeah, this bit of footage that was shot in our rehearsal room was actually very boring and very crap, because it was the one early time that I've had to mime drums, and it just looks ridiculous.
Well, let's watch for it then, right now in fact. Have a look.
Come on, keep talking, 'cause it's true. Come on, abuse me more, I like it. Come on, keep talking, 'cause it's true.
Thank you, son. How you doing, buddy? Good. We'll be right back.
The band is Silverchair.
Gigs in Europe and North America.
Silverchair flew into New York City recently.
Silverchair.
Silverchair.
And the winner is Silverchair.
I'd gone out and seen them playing live around town a couple of times. And I mean, you know, they were good. They played a few covers, a lot of their original stuff. And, you know, you could sort of tell that they were just sort of coming to grips with what performing was about. So, you know, that was then, in 94.
Hours of practice, it's not a bad thing, but, yeah, they jam a lot.
To see them at the end of this year, you know, they've just got so much projection on stage. Like, they're really confident, you know, they've got their own thing happening up there.
We've not done flashy photo shoots with million-dollar photographers. We've not gone out and done hair and makeup and got them styled. It's all been very honest, and what you see is what you get.
Has it been full-on and intense?
Yeah, it's time-wise? Been pretty hard sometimes. I don't know, I just think it's bad coming back from a tour, and instead of having a break, you go back to school and everyone just considers that to be your break.
What does the future hold for you?
Well, it depends if you can get a real job, you know.
Do you reckon you will?
Oh, you can only try, really, can't you?
Where do you see your sound going next? Have you got plans?
Not at all.
It's kind of hard to plan anything, you know, just let the ball roll and...
Do you think there's a better way that people should dance to your music? Perhaps bring back partner dancing or something?
I like that.
Yeah, kind of a bit of a tango, you know.
Yeah. It all depends for what song. Like, sometimes you can be angry and kind of just do the twist or something.
Yeah, the twist.
But for love songs like Cemetery and stuff, maybe just, cheek to cheek.
Cheek to cheek, nice.
Anyway, getting back to the
greatest rock moments.
Moment. Yeah. I don't know. Recovery, that was pretty good at the end there.
When?
When you came out and played your harmonica.
That wasn't really a rock moment, I don't
know. Oh, we think it is.
Really?
I think it was a rock moment. Like, being able to play such a legendary song by such a legendary band and play it with such a, you know, a good down-to-earth person. And we really enjoyed being with, like, it was really very special for us, that moment.
Buddy! You get paid. Daniel walked off for that. Daniel, what's your greatest rock moment been?
I didn't hear what Ben said, so mine would probably be playing with you on Recovery. That was just amazing, like, just playing with someone that we respect and admire so much. That Discovery guy.
They reckon that was their greatest moment. Do you reckon we should pay them? Maybe we should just give their stuff back.